the pleasure of welcoming Stephen Pells. Stephen is a hydrologist and a hydrogeologist. You're the first one of those I've ever met, so. Recently he worked on the independent review of the hydrology of Thirlmere Lakes with his father, Dr Phillip Pells. Stephen's research on how the depressurisation of coal seams can impact upon water systems is of particular relevance to us here today. Welcome, Stephen.
We didn't have any previous emotional investment in the region, and we thought it would be a good opportunity to practice science in its pure form and say, well, what does the data say? And we would hope that if anyone else, given the same facts that we've pulled out, would arrive at the same conclusions. So where is it, Thirlmere Lakes? I explained that before. It's just a tiny bit in there, as seen from the space shuttle. And obviously we're down here today. I'll just show you some photos quickly, which I'll flick through of the Thirlmere Lakes, which will highlight what the current problem is. This is Lake Werribee, which they used to call the boating lake. Lake Coorajar, which we used to call the swimming lake. Lake Nerebarang. And the cause of concern is in recent times, the lakes are completely dry. This lake over here, which is Lake Nerebarang, is completely dry. This is what they call the boating lake, which has only had a few inches of water in it. A photo of Lake Nerebarang more recently. Nerebarang again. This is the Nerebarang. This is the swimming lake, and more of a groveling lake in that photo. Swimming lake again, a boating lake. And this highlights the problem here. If you look at this photo and the next photo, we sort of drew what we thought would be where that wharf was, a jetty, and you can see there's a big difference in water levels. So that was the problem. Again, looking at the region, this is the lakes here, and if you put in, that's where the longmore mines are for Tamil pottery. So they're quite close to the lakes. So obviously there's been a theft at the jewellery store, and there's someone standing outside that's got a bunch of diamonds in his hand, and people have said, well, it's the mines that have taken all the water. And one thing people have said, which is probably incorrect, is that it's due to subsidence from longmore mining. And look, at the outset of this study, we basically ruled out that subsidence of fracking is the cause of the loss of water. We think the mine is too far away to affect that. But as you can see, the mine is within 700 metres of the lakes. When they do longmore mining, this is a photo of, just pointing where it is, these longmore panels in here. You saw that machine before that basically excavating the coal seam. Looking here, before they start mining, there's obviously gas in the coal, as we've talked about, and that's a risk to mining. Even at this particular colliery, I think in 1985, a man was killed when they were working down there from explosion from the gas. And they've had various means over the years to try and deal with this. And the current method is to go into the mine before they pull the coal out, and for every one of these little holes is a horizontally drilled bore. And they basically depressurise and pull all the water out of the coal seam before they get there, and the gas too, so we're removing the gas risk. Now this is quite similar to what was undertaken with coal seam gas. This is in the Yongi Visa photo of showing someone where the bores are. And they put a vacuum pressure on this bore and extract water for a period of, in this case, it was about 6 months before they actually started mining. I won't go into detail on this picture, this is showing the quantities of water that was taken out of the mine. And the longmore panels are the closest to the lakes around here. So they're taking about 2 million to 8 million litres a day of water out of the mine. It's quite a large quantity of water. Look, it's spread out over a large area, but nonetheless it's a large quantity. When we started the study, we hoped we'd be able to just go and find a record of historical water levels of the lakes, like something you can get from Lake George. Unfortunately, it wasn't the case. No one's ever measured the water levels at the Thirlmere Lakes, despite them being World Heritage listed feature. But we can get photographs. So we had to pull together what we think is a historical series of water levels. This is an example of a photograph from 1884. This down here is a feature that they had for pumping water out of the lakes for the railways at the time, and that's still there. So we can pick a level off that, which we're happy is probably plus or minus half a metre. And we've done that for a lot of photos. Aerial photographs, we can lay over the topography of the region, and again, pick off a water level. We think, again, in plus or minus half a metre. There's lots of aerial photographs through time. You can see 1949, the lakes were quite dry. And this is prior to mining. This is an example of the time series of water levels we've put together at the lakes. You can see that historically, back in the Federation drought and in the World War II drought, the lakes, available data suggests the lakes were quite low, and this is before mining. And for a period of over 50 years, the lakes were quite high, and people enjoyed their amenity then. Over here, over the last 20 years, the water levels have been declining fairly consistently. Now, over here is the period where the longmore mines came into the area. So straight away you can see there's a correlation between when the mining turned up and when the water levels started going down. We also know that during the 2006 we had a major drought. At the time we were going through it, people were calling it the largest drought on record. which is more of an indication of people's idea of what record is than what the drought was. We categorise the drought as a 5-year drought, so it comes in about here as the sixth most intense drought over the last 100 years. And the droughts of the World War II and the Federation were much more severe. And the water levels were low then, but probably not dry. I did a hydrological model of the lakes, and to lay those if you haven't been involved, it's basically you draw a watershed which part of the rainfall is going to flow towards the lake, and to simulate what the lakes might have been before mining came in. This is a 3D view of it, it's slightly exaggerated vertical scale, but you can see a line around the outline showing the watershed or the catchment flowing towards those lakes. And hydrological modelling is basically the accounting method. At the end of the year when we pay our tax, we have to make account for the money that we've spent or not spent, and it's quite clear that if we spend more than we earn, then our bank balance goes down, and if we earn more than we spend, our bank balance goes up. And hydrological study is essentially that. We count on a daily basis, in this case, how much water went into the system and how much water went out, and you can track what the water levels are going to be in the lakes. And so we've got rainfall records over about 100 years, and we can make estimations of how much of that might have evaporated and been transpired by plants, with the excess going as runoff into the lakes or seeping into the ground as infiltration. Again, some of the water is picked up by the plants and roots again and taken off to the atmosphere. Some moves through the soil into the lakes. Some we call recharge into regional groundwater. Of that, some goes across into the lakes. And there's a bit we call deep recharge, which is lost further down into a deeper system. Now, you can see, the analogy is simple, like accounting. It's almost like you've got lots and lots of spending and lots of things to add up. It's quite complicated to do, but this is the task of hydrology. And look, I didn't count it myself, I've got a computer to do it for me, but on a daily basis, we made an estimation of the water that goes in and out and what that meant to what the water levels might be. We'll also add that at this location, historically, people who know the Thirlmere Lakes, there's a pump house down near the lakes, and it moves water. At some stage, they were moving water to get to the trains in the area, so we had to account for that too. What does it show us? On this graph, hopefully people can understand this, these little green dots here are water levels we picked off from aerial photographs. I apologise for that. And this line here is the simulation that we've done from my hydrological study. So I ran the model many, many times over, changing the parameters to try and get what I think is the best match of historical data with what the model says. And you can see that clearly there's a variation in the lakes from climate. The point of interest is more recently, and I'll zoom in on this part here, that the model basically says that the water level should have gone down in response to the 2006 drought, but probably not as much as we've seen. And there's a misclose between about a metre to 2 metres between what we're seeing and what we should have been seeing, if it was just natural. Again, for a different lake, the same story, and if you see on this area, my model is saying that the water should be about 1.5 to 2.5 metres higher than what we're seeing. So, we'll go and explain that a bit more. This is a cross-section looking through the lakes on the side, Nerigaring over here and Lake Werribee, I think. This layer here is a Broad Hill claystone. It's considered a lot. People in the mining industry like to see that as a plastic sheet that stops any water going through. We've postulated that it's actually been eroded in this part here, and that's maybe contributed to some of the effects that we've seen. We entered that geology into a groundwater model just to see if it was plausible that the effects had propagated from the mine to the lakes. That figure up there is exaggerated vertical scale. This is what it looks like at one-to-one scale. This here is the mine. When you do longwall mining, they remove the coal and they let the roof fall in and after them. And that basically pulls in a big area they call the gulf, which is where rock is falling. We've drawn that there. In coal sand gas, they remove the water, so the effects are similar to what I'm about to show you, but there isn't this area here, so you just have to ignore that. In this model, we were quite kind to the mine, we didn't simulate any of the fracturing or substance that would normally occur from normal mining. This is a simulation of what we think water should look like in a natural condition. Basically, it's flowing from the higher areas down here, seeping through the ground through various layers, and eventually to come out of the Barga River or go further away. When the mine goes in, assuming it depressurizes this is the bull I see in here, this is about a month after mining, showing the propagation of depressurization. This is about a year after mining, and this is about 10 years after mining. And look, there's many ways of running these models, but this is an example, and it shows that it's plausible that the effects of depressurization would propagate that far in that time and affect the water levels in the lakes. It's important to know that the speed at which that depressurization goes is somewhat faster than the speed at which the water travels. People in the mining industry will emphasize, and it's true, that the water moves very slowly through the ground, but the rate in which pressure moves through the ground is much faster. Just to highlight it again, I don't know what it's called, a particle track. So each one of these here, you probably might not be able to see, there's a little particle here which we put it there and see where that drop of water would have gone over time. And you can see this is what we expect it would do before mining occurs. And after mining, you expect those same particles to go down towards the mine. So there's a major change in the area in terms of the pressure distribution of water in the aquifers. In our reports, which are available online, you're welcome to download them, we've gone through, I guess more scientifically, step by step, you know, what the findings are and what's led us to our conclusions. But I'll just cut to the chase, and this is our hypothesis. Is that without doubt, the drought has affected the water levels in the lakes, and the lakes have been affected majorly by that. But the longwall mining has, in our view, also contributed to the water levels and will continue to compromise the levels that we see in there. There's been a lot of rainfall recently, and I'm going to go up there again this afternoon and pick up a logger that we've put in the lakes, and we'll be constantly revising our findings. But I'm quite confident to say that the mine has impacted the water levels in those lakes, and it's not through fracturing or from subsidence, it's just through depressurization of the coal seam, in the same way that CSG gas extraction does. Just to emphasise this bit, deep recharge, basically in summary, we believe that this value here of water going down into deep recharge is increased because of the mining. And with respect to this diagram, you can't just increase one quantity without affecting all the others. So if you increase this deep recharge, you're taking water out of this whole system and ultimately out of what would have gone to the lakes. Not finished yet, we're doing more studies. As I said, I'm heading up there this afternoon to get some more data. And we are ongoing with this study because it's quite interesting. Look, when we started this study, our aim was not to be political. We thought we're going to be scientific about this, we're not trying to buy into a political argument. We haven't succeeded in that aim. And I read this article in Scientific American, which I think explains it well now. And I'll read it out loud. But the practice of science itself cannot possibly be apolitical because it takes nothing on faith. The very essence of the scientific process is to question long-held assumptions about the nature of the universe, dream up experiments to test those questions, and based on those observations, to incrementally build knowledge that is independent of our beliefs and assumptions. A scientifically testable claim is utterly transparent and can be shown to be either true or false, whether the claim is made by a king or a president, a pope, a congressman, or a common citizen. Because of this, science is inherently anti-authoritarian and a great equalizer of political power. So we intend to continue this study. It may become science political because the nature of science is, but